I will just start with an introduction to Derek Simons and Peter Schenkega of HNS, and truly excited to have their voices as part of this global lecture series in urban design. And we have students from around the world as part of this lecture series, not only students from Columbia University, but urban designers from all around the world, and you are all welcome. And we're so thrilled to be in dialogue with all of you today. So, you know, HNS is a firm that truly has been a global leader in many ways. First of all, with a kind of what I would call a creative and collaborative approach to urban design, landscape architecture, planning, and systems thinking. They have an incredible range of projects from, you know, new energy landscapes to living with water that span from speculation to built work. And we, you know, I just feel that they have been such a strong voice in the profession globally, pushing ahead these notions of not only the agency of practice and the agency of designers within the built environment, but also kind of through kind of very creative and frankly applied thought processes applied to climate change and applied to, you know, multiple scales, from the scale of a development or an artwork, as they'll be showing, to broader regional transformative landscape projects. So it's truly, you know, instructive for us as designers, as urban designers, as landscape architects and planners to hear from both Peter and Dirk this morning and or in this afternoon, wherever you are. And I couldn't imagine a firm more. I've been, you know, hyping your lecture all semester because in the Columbia context, we are working on a project on revisioning the Mississippi River and transforming that into a living river system alongside the revitalization of the many towns and cities that are along it. So I couldn't think of a firm that was more apt to kind of put some contextualizing words and some inspiring kind of process notes to our class. But welcome, Peter and Dirk, and thank you again. We have our, at the end of the lecture, David Smiley, the assistant director, will be moderating some Q&A, so folks are welcome to put your questions in the chat box. And then I guess I would just remind everybody kind of formally that this lecture is being recorded for academic purposes only. It'll be on the Columbia server. And that once we start sharing screen, if you would kindly turn your video off. And then just so Peter and Dirk, you're aware, we'll turn the videos back on for Q&A so you can see faces and have a little bit more interaction. But welcome again. I'm just so thrilled to have you both here with us today. Thank you for being with us.
Okay. Thank you, Kate, for inviting us. Well, in the pre-corona days, invitations like this would include a trip to New York. Well, I'm afraid we have to think of something else to see your beautiful city again. But please let me introduce us. This is HNS Landscape Architects in the Dutch landscape, as you can see. This is my colleague, Peter Schenkega, and this is me, Dirk Simons. And our lecture will be in two parts. First, I will try to share the emotion I felt when I was waking up in the Anthropocene one morning. And I want to present four possible positions, four worldviews towards this new age of mankind. To manage expectations, none of these positions seem to have the silver bullet to solve all the problems we are facing. After that disappointment, to lift our spirits, I want to cross these four worldviews with our four professional attitudes that we as landscape architects and urbanists have in our toolbox. My colleague Peter will, after the intermission, show some HNS projects covering two of these four professional attitudes, because you are working In the Mississippi Living River studio, we decided to emphasize the Room for the River projects because as an office, we were involved in this program on all levels of scale. After Peter's showcase of projects, I will be back for a couple of minutes with some afterthoughts. Let me start with a look back to the 2014 International Architecture Biennale Rotterdam that we curated. I themed it urban by nature to emphasize that we are nature. We live in nature and nature lives within us. We are urban by nature. The city is our habitat, our ecology. We filled Kohlhaas Kunsthof from the bottom to the rim with projects about the necessity of gardening, the role landscape architecture could have in mediating with nature, the fine-tuning of the metabolism of the city to see if these mega structures can play a role in the circular economy, reweaving the urban carpet to explore how we can make these changing in the existing situation, in the existing urban landscapes. There is no new frontier anymore. And exploring the underground, maybe that's a new frontier. And of course, projects about the adaptation to climate change, where we featured the rebuild by design projects that were in their planning, in their hopeful planning phase in 2014. But the overarching theme was the Anthropocene, sketched in several essays in the catalog of the Biennale. I was often asked, what's all this ado about the Anthropocene? Do we need this grandstanding? Is it just the latest metaphor of the environmental movement to raise the level of alarm? What did change and what didn't change? Let me start with a book that changed my way of looking at the environment. It contains the proceedings of an international conference at the 1955.
Interrupt yeah. you. I thought I had a problem here, but I think no one has seen your screen now. Yeah. I don't know if you shared your screen again.
No.
So we missed some first images.
Okay. Let me try to share it again. No, this is not good. Share screen. Share. And then. Can everybody see my screen now? Yes?
Yes. Thank you so much. Yes.
Okay. Well, you missed a lot of fun. You missed this. This is Peter. This is me. This is the structure of the lecture. This is overlooking urban by nature. And here we are, starting with a book that changed my way of looking at the environment. It contains the proceedings of an international conference at Princeton in 1955. Some 150 scientists, people like urban sociologist Lewis Mumford and the theologist like Teilhard de Chardin discussed man's role in changing the face of the earth. I bought it secondhand in the 70s. It's a 900 pager, good for days of reading and leafing through, with wonderful studies such as the reconstruction of the forest coverage of Central Europe. And if we look at the table of contents, one observes that all the present day themes were already there in the mid 50s, the age of fossil fuels, the specifics of the urban meteorology, the way man influences plant communities, etc. So what's new? Well, first of all, I think the epistemological change that new instruments brought to link all these different elements together For instance, in this beautiful 1918 portrait of the USA by system ecologist H.P. Oden. Here, the human economy and the natural world are described in one and the same ecosystem model, suggesting that we will be able to predict the whole system's performance. And well, I'm afraid that will be a promise forever. Even quantum computers and big data won't allow real modeling here because we just lack theory and are still unaware of much of the cause and effect relationships and the sheer complexity of the whole. Well, big data, of course, can be very helpful in producing evocative pictures like this present from your NASA. A humongous amount of data has been aggregated to animate a year in the CO2 life of our living planet. I show this picture to make clear that the real rupture in thinking was the observation that we do not influence on the scale of an ecosystem, on the scale of a landscape, but that we have disrupted some of the Earth systems. The Earth systems that are drastically altered are the geochemical cycles, thereby disrupting the climate and the acidification of the oceans. The sediment flows that are now that all the big rivers are dammed for energy production. Land use changed, fuels by reclamation for agriculture. And urbanization, and finally, and most important, the erosion of biodiversity. This reckoning of man as a global force was the main reason for our fellow countryman, Paul Crutzen, to coin the term the Anthropocene. And once the implications of this idea sink in, it will not let go. The history of man is twinned with the history of the planet. The realm of the necessity and that of the free will merge. A night without much sleep, thinking about it, made me wake up in the Anthropocene the next day. This idea is seriously being studied by the Stratigraphic Committee of the Royal Geological Society. The focus of the debate is on when this Anthropocene is supposed to have started. You have the old school that proclaimed that the migration of mankind over the globe, hunting the large vertebrates and predators to extinction, will be the start of the Anthropocene. The pragmatic school that at the obtaining of the patent of the steam engine to James Watt, and the start of the large scale use of fossils might be the good point to start it, or perhaps, and this school seems to get the upper hand in the discussion, at the end of World War II, when the atomic bomb testing left clear geological markers of radioactive isotopes at the start of what is called the Great Acceleration. And rendered in a graph, this great acceleration looks like this. You can see that all the indicators of population, use of natural resources, speed up in an exponential way and go almost through the roof. Question is, where are we, what are we looking at? Is this progress? Is this an apt way of summing up the environmental problems? Or can we blame the baby boomers for this? Or are we looking at the apocalypse as Bruno Latour suggested? And we are in the middle of it. That's an interesting view. No black horseman stuff and a zip bang moment, but our exploding wealth as a sort of extended apocalypse. For now, let's settle on it, that is, it is the start of the Anthropocene. And if we, agree on living in the Anthropocene, there are basically four different philosophical positions or attitudes one can take to this condition. In this scheme, based on the work of the Australian philosopher Clive Hamilton, two extremes are mixed. On the vertical axis, the way one could look at the position of mankind, well, at the top as a futile, modest species, impotent in changing the course of the planetary systems, and at the other extreme, at the bottom, a mighty, almost omnipotent mankind. On the horizontal axis, on the left, the world as a sort of unchanging backdrop, our inexhaustible sores and pits where human projects land or and our utopias are projected on. On the right, the living and mighty planet that is not passive at all, but it is able to cause unpredictable troubles if its systems are disrupted. And this is the strange loop I want to take you through these four positions. Let's begin at the top left corner, where the idea is that man is unable to change creation on his own strength, and that the planet and all there's on it serves as being the crown of creation. I think that a large proportion of the Earth's inhabitants are actually still ignorant of, for instance, climate change and its possible implications. That number could decrease due to information and education, but also to disasters. There's also a hard core of malicious ignorance, the climate deniers who frame it as a big conspiracy of the elite. It's a hoax. We must realize that these denialists will not disappear given correct information. Thanks to autocrats like former President Trump, the Brazilian President Bolsonaro, and President Modi of India, a strong political movement has started, of which climate change is just about the core. And cognitive dissonance is digging the heels in deeper, even when confronted with an undeniable truth. It also shows how environmental problems ended up in a left-right contradiction in a possible fatal way. We must also realize that there is a denier in each of us. There's a voice that evokes our politicians must act now, but at the same time, a voice that whispers, I hope they don't have to. I would hate to give up my privileges. You could say that the hardcore deniers locked themselves up in an everlasting present and a longing for a non-existent past. This is similar to the situation in the brilliant film, The Truman Show, where Jim Carrey does not notice that he is the protagonist of a reality TV show in which everything is aimed at maintaining this illusion for him. That comes to an end only when he gradually sees that it is a constructed world. He eventually discovers the edges, escapes to a staircase, and makes a final bow for his audience of millions. But what is behind that door? In which reality does he end up? In which reality do people end up who conclude that denial is not sustainable? Most likely in the quadrant of modernism and eco-modernism, where the promise is the best is always yet to come, and where the great acceleration is considered as progress. And where the idea of eternal progress is kept alive, it is the world in which economic growth can be combined with the reduction of the ecological footprint. Should this growth give problems? Well, that can all be solved with rational means. Eco-modernism is a variant of this, in which we simply use technical means to come up with rational solutions for the problems of the Anthropocene as well. or construct qualifying stories that the consequences will not be too bad. It is a radically optimistic shoot of the environmental movement that has its most focal voice in the Breakthrough Institute. Mankind is ingenious. Science and technology will help us if things really go wrong. They will invent something to science our way out of the problems one day. Well, in this solutionist way of looking, clearly defined problems in this bulleted list are solved rationally one by one. Geochemical cycles influence, well, there we have the circular economy. Sediment flows, well, we just start an hard coastal defense. The acidification of the ocean, well, adding iron ions and chalk surely will help. The climate change, why don't we try geoengineering? Biodiversity eroded, why? Novel ecosystems do the same job. And maybe in the near future we have de-extinction problems and can bring extinct species back. Shifting land use, well, the new green revolution will feed the billions of people. Well, this is perhaps a good moment to make some general remarks on modernism. In this Enlightenment view on the world, nature and its resources are an unchanging constant. The factor, the moving direction, is emancipation. As you can see from the key notions, modernism promises freedom and breaking loose from the chains of nature. Both politicians and designers formulate their ideals in solutionist and utopian terms. The most striking example of the drive of this technological optimistic belief in progress is perhaps Norman Bel Geddes' General Motors Pavilion at the 1939 World Fair in New York, in which the Americans were prepared for the blessings of mass mobilities and the type of cities adapted to that. As you can see, people can hardly wait for this utopia to materialize. 30,000 visitors a day, but a button pinned, I have seen the future. In our time, the Futurama might be the image of the mighty man that rises from the book Homo Deus by Yuval Harari. Man becomes more machine and the machine more human. And thanks to big data in our smart cities, we can predict and regulate our behavior. The great disconnection between biological and technological evolution has begun. For the real techno enthusiasts, the leap to colonization of Mars is a small step after making the Earth untenable. How this mentality translates into the climate problem is aptly expressed by excellent CEO and former Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Trump administration, Rex Tillerson. It's only an engineering problem. Adding sulfur particles, beaches of olefine, and iron into the ocean will solve the problems, but the side effects can be unpredictable and disastrous if the Earth is not the unchanging backdrop for human action. As modernism supposes, the sorcerers as apprentice effects could be disastrous. Modernism is hitting its boundaries, and its golden age seems to be gradually coming to an end. The Earth turns to be an active party. The promised emancipation of shredding the change turns into a constant concern. The consensus that it succeeds at the same time to grow and to reduce the footprint turns bleaker every day. freedom and detachment turns into their opposite, whereby man becomes, in a philosophical sense, an embedded subject, connected via a web of other living and dead actors. Designers have to wonder whether they will remain the faithful accessory of modernism, like they always were, or be part of some counterforce. If we must abandon this familiar belief in progress, it might be good to say that, to my estimation, about 90% of the environmental discourse takes place in the left part of this figure. Both positions are embedded within the existing economic paradigm of neoliberalism. Admittedly, it is very difficult to propose a coherent alternative. As the philosopher Slavoj Žižek observed, it's easier to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism. There is a growing rift between the left side and the right side of our typology, as if someone would have cut the quadrant in the bark of a growing tree. Before we look at the right side of the scheme, where one assumes that the earth is an active force, we must realize that for reductionist scientists as well as modernists, this is a kind of superstition, which is nicely illustrated by this little IKEA ad.
Many of you feel bad for this lad. That is because you're crazy. It has no feeling, and the new one is much better.
Superstition, indeed. And, well, there's also let's say, a way where the right side sees the right side, the left side. There are, in their few naive reductionists, playing with their atomic kit. I sometimes think that the barrier between the two halves of the figure is being formed by the difference between reductionist thinking and holism, the people still holding the idea on the left side that we are in a gradual process that can be reversed, and at the right side, people convinced that we are that we forced a rupture in the Earth systems with complex and irreversible effects. Well, let's jump over the fence and see what's there. Starting in the sector where we combine the modest mankind with the belief of the living planet, championed by Lovelock's Gaia theory, seeing the Earth as a self-regulating superorganism. And behind the philosophical jargon of ontological pluralism, there's the idea that all sorts of way of being may and must exist side by side. The ways of Western culture are equal to other cultures and the ways of being of indigenous people. After decades of critical studies, the social sciences about race, gender, faith, capitalism has finally arrived at human complacency. In post-humanism, man is supposed to take a step back and realize that he is only a small cog in the web of life. If we considered the earth and nature as an immobile black cloth, a backcloth to the continuous history show of human civilization, more and more people are convinced that the stage itself has started to move and participates in this performance. The once solid border between culture and nature is crumbling on all fronts. Things are happening on this cutting edge that we don't have yet the right words for. Hybrids are being formed. In this way of seeing, everything we have mentioned so far is essentially the twinning of what we used to call natural and human processes. So even the climate is a hybrid, and perhaps a larger artifact than the endless urban landscapes we built. It is not strange to see initiatives emerge these days to give landscape or landscape elements their own legal status, such as the recognition of the Whanganui River in New Zealand. The Maori has been negotiating for that for the last 140 years, and it is no coincidence that ontological pluralism has played a part in this breakthrough. Closer to my home, the establishment of the Embassy of the North Sea, very chic on the Lange Voorhout, where all the other embassies are, in the aim of emancipating the North Sea in all its diversity to become a political player to all the collectives of people and non-humans, even the abiotic might have their own ontology, or the enriching experience and design practice to allow yourself a vacation from being human, like artist Thomas Twaits managed when he transformed into Goatman for a couple of weeks. And more within reach, immerse yourself in an ocean of air where your metabolism and that of an old growth forest get in close contact in virtual reality seen in the Saatchi Gallery. Well, criticism of this approach is that man tries to make himself small as an equal in the web of life, but with that he puts his influence under the grain. Man has caused a catastrophe already, has an unimaginable impact and must take responsibility accordingly. If we are a plague organism, we better be a reflective one. And this is the starting point of anthropocentrism 2.0, also known as eco-pragmatism. This is the perhaps gloomier or more realistic movement that takes responsibility and distinguishes itself from eco-modernism by the estimation that the worst might still be avoided versus the best is always yet to come. The diagnosis of the situation is also quite different. All hybrids enter the dance floor together with humanity. There seems to be a perfect storm building up of unpredictable events that hopefully will teach us to ride the cycle. What we know of such complex systems is that they are fundamentally unpredictable. Now, countless bifurcations of developments, and most of all, they never return to their point of origin. The arrow of time points relentlessly in only one direction, and I'm still educated with concepts like the balance of nature, and that we as a humanity overstepped this balance and only had to take a few steps back to restore that balance. Now we know that there was never such a thing as the balance of nature, and that we will never return to that calm and stable Holocene with some technical interventions. No misunderstanding here. This new anthropocentrism is not anti-technological. Technology is considered in a Gluttian way. It can be a blessing for humanity, but also its downfall. In this way of seeing, the ethical discussion about science and technology is dominant. Not everything that is possible could and should be allowed to happen. Technology has to be domesticated, and that might be a hard thing to do, observing that technology seems to have taken an autonomous course and is gaining momentum. What are the kind of perspectives for action that eco-pragmatism has to offer? How can man take responsibility? My personal intuition is that these lay in the realm of recovery, repair, undoing, defragmentation, etc. And a moving example for me is Brazilian photographer Sebastião Salgado, who was an embedded photographer in all the disaster areas of the world in the first 30 years of his career. He got a burnout and an artistic crisis and complained his soul was broken. As an antidote, he made a beautiful homage to life on the planet and nature in his book, Genesis. And also its indigenous people. The reason I wanted to forward the Salgados as landscape activist is that together with his wife Lelia, he stepped out the observing and commentary role as a photographer into a direct acting role. They decided to reforest the eroded and completely cleared hacienda of his father. You see that in the top left. They did this with 400 endemic plants and tree species of the Atlantic rainforest and were proving that the erosion of biodiversity don't have to be irreversible. Their initiative, organized in Instituto Terra, proved to be the idea for the wide surrounding of the farm and after that for the whole region. Offering an action perspective and act, their nurseries now have a capacity of 1 million seedlings per year. Wim Wenders made a beautiful film, The Salt of the Earth, of this Verdegang. Retro engineering could also be an acting perspective for anthropocentrism 2.0, a sort of planet repairman, like removing the thousands of dams without any function to re-establish the possibility of fish migration, or working with natural processes instead of hard civil engineering to satisfy human needs, such as with the sand engine, where Peter and I were at the cradle of as a new way of coastal protection. Well, finally, let's take an overview of the position taken in this first part of the lecture. Between them, you can suspect the various ideological fault lines that will determine the environmental and political debate in the coming decades. Because there is an enormous amount of political energy in the dynamics between the different positions. But the four positions typology is also a handy navigating tool in the Anthropocene. You can plot the position of almost all the environmental philosophers here, Bruno Latour, here. You see some other, Yuval Harari, Clive Hamilton, who is the father of this fourfold typology, and Ayn Rand of Atlas Shrugged, and of course you can also navigate your local bookstore with the four quadrants. Politically, it's going to be, oh, there's another one, sorry, and another one. Politically, it's going to be a bumpy ride too. And it's really a challenge for our politicians trying to find the right course in a situation where you, yourself, and your constituents are offenders and victim at the same time. What you see now is that politicians hide behind the line that there is no public support and that they act like a sort of intermediary for the public fury. What we hope that they act like responsible delegates chosen by us to see that they protect the physical existence of our low-lying delta and prevent the situation where les gilets jaunes, the protesters, have to be exchanged for yellow life vests in a way. To address the design community, we represented these four ways of looking into a peeping box for the Vienna Biennale that opened last week. As said earlier, the design community is still largely in an in-between state between modernism and the full acknowledgement of the Anthropocene being the herald of malleability and thereby for so long accomplices to one or more of the many crises we are in. What are we doing? What are our perspectives? Are we solving? Are we, let's say, making a contribution to solving the world's problem, like Alan Bircher thinks systemic design can change the world? Well, I think that we have to realize that sometimes we might be part of the problem rather than the solution. Can we form a counterforce? What agency can design or landscape architecture have? I think we can't be too cocky about what design can do. We are still recovering from the hangover of the period of spatial determinism, where we thought that almost all societal problems could be solved with spatial means. Already in the 70s of the 20th century, the Austrian architect Hermann Cech came to the sobering conclusion, architecture is not life itself. Architecture is the backdrop, the background. All the other things are not architecture. Architecture won't solve our political, our social, not even our environmental problem, just as music won't solve our noise pollution problems. But so not solving noise pollution problems didn't stop musicians from composing music. Our contribution to the world problems might be a little bit more indirect. This might precisely be why there is still a tension felt between the will to engage with environmental problems and the pride designers take on keeping a critical distance that is needed in their eyes to have a cultural relevance. There are ways, of course, to combine the two. What can we contribute to entangle this conundrum? I want to dissect our possible roles into four professional attitudes. That of our day-to-day practice as a landscape architect, that of a landscape activist, certainly our role as landscape researchers and research by design, and finally that of land artists. In the second half of our two-part lectures, Peter will give some HMS projects that are, well, showing that working for a paying client doesn't have to stand in the way of making a meaningful contribution, and that of a landscape artist. So these two niches will be handled in the second half of the lecture. Thanks so far. We have a quarter of an hour intermission.
So I'd like to suggest that everyone, you know, bring that cup of coffee back over to your screen, and we'll get started on the next portion, which is, thank you for Dirk for those sort of very contextualizing words. And now we will hear more from Peter on some projects. Take it away, Peter.
Yes, thank you, Kate. Well, Dirk introduced the different approaches or different roles you can take as a landscape architect. And in order to make it a smooth transition from his story, we thought it was a good idea to start with this this project in which we try to operate as an artist, or that's the result, the outcome of this this project. It's a noise reduction park we designed. It's a park area in the neighborhood of Schiphol Airport, our main airport, close to Amsterdam. And it's, well, special thing. The airport is positioned in the Haarlemmermeer, which is a big polder area close to Amsterdam, originally deep open agricultural land, with a lot of space for developments like an airport, but also an area in which much houses were built in the past and still are being built. And also the airport is developing. After the polder track, the polder runway was created. There was a lot of complaints. There were a lot of complaints from people living in the neighborhood of the area. Complaints because of the noise they experienced. And Schiphol was forced to measure the noise much better than they did before. And they were also had the assignment to reduce the noise to those houses with 10 decibel. And it was especially low frequency noise caused by airplanes rolling on the tracks to their runways or from the runways to the terminals. And by measuring this, by accident, they discovered that after the crops were removed from the fields and the lands were ploughed, that the noise was much lower than before. And that made those researchers think, how could this work? What happens? And apparently the reflection of the noise by those ridges really did something in their measuring. So, they discovered some interesting systems. So this is more or less how it works. And then the idea came up, can we construct some structures in this area between the residential areas and the airway? And can we design something that reflect those waves in order to reach the goal of lowering of 10 decibel? And that was the point where we as an office were involved. And the idea was to make some ridges that were higher, of course, than the bluffed land, ridges of around 3 meters with a sharp top and also a sharp ditch in the middle. And this sharp shape should help to reflect the noise. And then they started to do so. They started to build those one of those ridges somewhere in the agricultural land. Real size to test. Yeah, this is a ridge after it's just constructed. And here, until it's gone. Now it's gone. So they start to test with large speakers on this car to make a lot of noise. And on the other side, they start to measure, and it really appeared to work. And it worked much better than they expected. And that was really interesting, of course. And then a plan was made to introduce all those ridges in the agriculture area. But at the same time, there was also a park area that was at the edge of the residential area that was already being designed. The design was quite far already. And then this was the original park design. Meadows, trees, tree lines, a lot of open space. And we certainly got the idea to change, to ask if we could change this park design and to introduce those ridges in this park to make something special, working noise buffering or noise reflecting a landscape. We worked together with an artist also, and together we found out that it was a good idea to, following the principles from the noise, come up with some kind of a stamp, a pattern with this size and these degrees of angles, and to use the sharp angles to make it also an expressive landscape. And this is the final park design. It's not completely north orientated, but you can see that at the north, that's the left side of the drawing, that the pattern is more dense. There's an open area in between, and it becomes less dense at the southern side. And there are only some free pyramids in the open field. And this pattern is rolled out over this area, and it also works as some kind of a large maze, yeah? A maze where you can walk around. And there's also a model in the area of this maze structure. This is it seen from above. So yeah, a very open, large area where the ridges are orientated to reflect the sound, where paths cut the ridges, and by opening and densing the pattern, you experience the area in a very interesting way. And here's a short movie of the project.
Noise Reduction Park, Schiphol. After the new runway was built at Schiphol Airport, the ground noise near the adjacent residential area increased to such an extent that measures were required. It appeared that the ground noise largely disappeared when farmland was ploughed. By dispersing noise, the noise is reduced, and this mechanism forms the technical basis for the design of a ridged landscape. The park was developed as a single land art project and is, at the same time, Europe's largest maze.
Well, here are some images of the area. Flower fields round. Maintenance is important, of course, because it needs to be empty and smooth, also those ridges, in order to keep its function. And look through those ridges, and one in the opposite direction, the central path that cuts through it. And here you're looking over it, and you also see one element added by an artist, the artist we work together with. Some kind of a shell and or an ear positioned there to listen, to listen how it works. I'm switching now to a completely other issue. More connecting to the studio you're doing also. It's about our work at the Dutch River area as part of the Room for the River program, and also some things we did before on dike reinforcement. The office has been involved in rivers actually since the founding of the office, but I got back to that. We worked on it for many years. First, something about Dutch River region, how it works, the system. The Netherlands over here is part of the Rhine Basin that stretches over part of Germany, part of France, but also Switzerland, the Alps, where all the rainwater and the melting snow is collected and all needs to pass our country on its way to the sea. And the Netherlands, of course, as you know, probably is a low country. Which mainly has a genesis in the last, let's say, 10,000 years, not completely, but the eastern part is more sandy. But after the ice ages ended and the seas started to raise, the land raised also by deposits of clay from the rivers and from the sea. And around 2,000 years ago, the present coastline started to come up. The dunes closed, and after the dunes, a lot of peat could grow. That's the brown color. So most part of the country is consisting of peat and clay land. And in this area, we through the centuries have been occupying this area. And of course, by occupying in this wet land, it was important to make it dry. And first, this happened by digging ditches in it. Later, pumps were installed. The peat was dug out also, And in the end, the Netherlands is one big puzzle with all small pieces, all different polders on different levels, but mainly below the sea level. And this model that's in the corridor of our office, this illustrates how this works. And the rivers are not lying in a valley in the Netherlands, but the rivers are actually surrounded by big dikes, and behind those dikes there's low-lying polderland. And this really illustrates why it's so risky and why we need to take a lot of care of our dikes, of course. A flooding is not a valley filling up, but is suddenly, by a breach, for example, a flooding of a whole area, including our main cities. Something of the origin of the river area. This is a map from, 100 years ago, around that. You could see in the white color, you can see the fluvial ridges, which are natural. And you can also see that on those fluvial ridges, the occupation started, people started to live there. And later, from medieval times, people started to build dikes along the rivers. And there's even also a dike perpendicular to the river to protect this area. Before the dikes were made, rivers could follow their own course, and they often choose new directions, and all those different patterns are lying on top of each other. And by manipulating this river system, it got it changed like this, more or less. The river dikes were closed at the end of the medieval times. Later, they started to build dikes. They started to lead all those little streams and combine them to one stream, also to make shipping possible. And that again happened somewhere in the 19th century on a much bigger scale. Yeah? And shipping was so important that it dominated the whole river system, the layout of the river. There's a typical cross section of the river. Normally, in case of low discharge, the river is here, the water is only here in its summer bed. Then there are groynes, they are built to keep the speed of the water so high that there's no or not as less as possible sedimentation in this shipping gully. Then there's a floodplain, and there's also a so-called winter dike. That's a dike that protects everyone that's living behind. And there are a lot of little dikes in the floodplains, and those dikes are built and maintained by the farmers to keep their land dry. Well, during the last century, a lot of space for a river, natural space for a river, was also minimized, mainly by growing cities, like you see here at the city of Arnhem, for example. You see a very wide winter bed, a very wide floodplain, but this winter bed was minimized by realigning the dike around it. And here, the result is a so-called urban bottleneck. And of course, this makes it hard for the water to pass in case of heavy of big discharges. And of course, the result is higher water levels, mainly upstream. Climate is changing. The river area was until 15 years ago safe to deal with an amount of 15,000 cubic meters per second to pass in a safe way to the sea without overtopping of our dikes. But 16,000 cubic meters was expected because of climate change. And on the long term, it can even be 18,000. And this amount of water happens, well, not so often, with a return period of around 1 to 1250. So that's also the safety for this this area, safety level. Let's skip this one. And of course, the natural reaction to higher water levels has always been the raising and enforcement of dikes. And in the 70s, especially, this went very rough in a rough way. Villages were taken down, removed, and a lot of cultural and ecological values disappeared from the river area. There was a lot of opposition by inhabitants, by ecologists, by people who love the landscape. So this process that was already going on of reinforcing the dikes, that stopped somehow for around 10, 15, sometimes 20 years. Not much was done on those dikes. In the 1995, this picture is from, the discharges were high. The water raced almost to the top of the dikes, and it became very, very clear that it was really dangerous, not doing things on those dikes. A lot of people had to be evacuated from the river area, and with a lot of work and a lot of hoping, the dikes kept in its in the place. They were not overtopped. The water was lowering just in time, you could say, but it became very clear that something needed to be done. But it was also clear that those old plans with removing all the qualities, that was not the way to go. Alternatives were developed. Our office was also involved in the thinking. This is a dike along the Waal River, constructed in just before 1998. In the section below, you see the old dike that's a bit lower, but also very steep and was not strong enough to the modern standards. So it needed to be higher and it also needed to be wider. But a standard dike with gentle slopes would look like a very thick thing in the landscape. So one of the ideas developed by our office was to make it gentle at the top and a bit steeper at the top and gentle at the bottom, so that you get a hollow-shaped dike section. And this still gives you the feeling that you're a little bit above the landscape. And that's a way to react actually on the old situation and also to make to build new qualities. And a part of the reinforcement measures were not constructed in the dike itself, but on the outside, a lot of clay was put here, and it could also go together with nature development at the dike toe. So this was a positive way of solving this problem. Some old qualities vanished, but you can also bring new qualities back, and at the end, everyone likes these transformed dike landscapes. This is a newer example. I've been working on it myself a few years ago. This was a dike along the Lek River. You see it here in section and here in a map. And this landscape in the central part of the Netherlands is really small scaled. Houses are lying close to the dike. You also see plantings. The land use is hitting the dike almost. And our idea was to not to build the dike as a standard mold of ground. If you would do so, you would get the section you see here below. And it means that there would be a fence here at my mouse, and that this whole area from there to there would be the domain of the water boards. One big barrier actually, as division of the landscape rather than a line in the landscape. And the idea to overcome this problem was to put a little bit of extra ground up on top of it and give it a very gentle slope here that it connects to the original height of the landscape over here. And by doing so, it was allowed to give the right to own and use this area to the people here, and you could bring back the existing land use after raising those dikes. And you can see it here, for example, this is where the dike starts, the dotted line. This part is used by as an integrated part of this parcel, and this is what you experience as the dike itself. Still, again, a way to make those new dikes, strong dikes, fit in the landscape. And this is an example of how people react on that. For example, here was an orchard. It needed to be removed to realized this dike reinforcement, and a vineyard came back. Huh? So that's a way people actually like and occupy the new landscape. But so far, the dike reinforcements, somewhere at the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, something special happened in the river area, and that was also part of a result of this plan. It's called a Plan Ooievaar. It's a plan part of a competition. Dirk was a part of the team who made this this plan, and it was a way to deal with a loss, permanent loss of nature in the agricultural area. And the idea, the concept, was to actually assign the whole floodplains along the rivers as a part of ecological backbone system. It's called the approach is called Casco Casco Benadering, Casco Plan. And by proposing this, the idea came up also to think about a special kind of nature in those areas. Not nature that's maintained a lot, but nature that has the power to develop itself, making use of good conditions. So it was more about creating conditions than about creating or planting the nature itself. So a completely new alliance between the rivers and the nature development that was already there, already starting. So the transformation of those typical sections I showed before was also imaginable. It was imaginable that a big part of the river area transformed into nature instead of being agricultural. And in these conditions, problems with dike reinforcement, the urgency of dike reinforcement on the one hand, and the positive approach about nature, those two things, these conditions led in the end to a completely different approach about dealing with water and high water in the river area. And it's all led to the Room for River project, with a lot of projects on a local scale that were constructed. The idea is that instead of higher dikes to deal with high water, that you could do something to keep the water as low as possible. And that's possible by widening of the river instead of narrowing, that you also have seen before. Just make more space, make more room for the river. That's the idea. So that's one special thing. The other special thing about this program is that it's not only about water safety or engineering, but it also was about spatial quality. The idea was that by constructing all those room for river measures, that also the environment should improve in a recreational way, ecological way, urban way, all kinds of ways. These are different, some, not all of them, different measures that are part of the Room for River project. For example, the relocation of dikes, remove the old dike, build a new dike a little bit more on the land side. The existing floodplains could be lowered, obstacles could be removed. Some high water channels are constructed, means extra river courses to provide extra discharge capacity. And in order to select those measures, the locations for those measures were also put on a list, actually, and were many of them. But all those measures work together. If you do something on the one side, you also need to take care of what's happening some kilometers upstream or downstream. And we needed to look at how those measures could contribute to the spatial quality. And as one way to come to an answer, we were involved in a team that made the long-term perspectives and long-term vision for a river area. And we tried to combine those measures in a logic way. And one idea was to integrate all those measures as close to the urban areas as possible. mainly because there's a problem, but also because the new orientation of those cities to the surrounding could improve with those measures. Another measure was other proposal was to spread it equally along the rivers. It's difficult for every municipality, you can say, and everyone has a little bit a benefit, maybe also. And this one is a very natural model where really big new rivers are constructing through the open land behind the fluvial ridges. Now this helped a bit to select those measures. Here are some of the room for the rivers measures that were selected. And I'm also going to tell you about our project in Kampen, Reven-Diep, IJssel Delta, and the other one is Nijmegen along the Waal. That comes a bit later. Here's a map with the 34 room for the river projects spread through the Netherlands along the IJssel River, which is the smallest one. The Rijn and Lek, that's the next one, and the Waal, that's the biggest river. It was a big program. Completion for most projects was in 2015-2016. And what's special also is the way the national and local governments worked together. It was a natural program, natural tasks or assignments per project. The local governments worked out their own projects and combined the assignment with the local qualities, local needs, local ambitions. And that's part of the success. And a national quality, which and Dirk was also a member of that, guided all those projects. So national government also helped the local governments to make it as good as possible. So now let's zoom into two of our projects. On a local scale, the first one is Room for the River in Nijmegen along the Waal. This is the map of the plan. This is the Waal River, the existing river that was already there. It's very big. You also see it on this aerial picture. You see also a lot of ships. It's the main shipping channel between Rotterdam and Germany. But I'll come back to that later. This was the situation before, during a situation of high water. On the left side, you see the old city of Nijmegen. And on the right side of the picture, you see the pretty empty agricultural land with some villages in there, like it was, I think this was somewhere in 1995, so it should be 25 years ago. And you can also see the railway bridge that connects north and south, and the bridge for cars over here. The city was actually completely orientated on the south side of the river. Right here you see the principle of Ruimte voor de Waal. This line that I show with my mouse, that's the original dike. This dike is partly removed. And it's brought back here in this red line. And that means that all this area is a part of the floodplain now. And there's also a large big gully over here constructed that takes out the water here, part of the water, and a large discharge capacity on its smallest point. And it reconnects to the Waal over here. And as part of the plan, some new bridges are constructed. And that's also important because Nijmegen decided already before river came up to develop a lot of houses on the northern side of the river. This was their old plan, their old sketch. And it's, remarkable that you can see that the city is completely filled in on the north side. This is was the existing dike, and intermediate zone with recreation and special kind of buildings was planned between the existing dike and the new city. So the whole recreational program was actually behind the river and completely not orientated on the floodplain. And the floodplain on this sketch is only colored with a light green color, not important for the city at all. In the room for the river process, different alternatives were part of the survey. This one is chosen, the dike realignment over here. And while this process was going on, the city of Nijmegen started to rethink about their orientation to the river. And the plan, like it was, you see over here, started to turn and also started to turn a lot. And the floodplains, in the end, were considered more as part of the city and also as a connecting part between north and south instead of a barrier. And as part of the Room for the River project, not only, but they already started with it, the whole new infrastructure in Nijmegen was also realigned. There's a new urban city ring, some bridges were constructed, and the floodplains were part of the of the park area. Well, this is the concept also. The floodplains bring the nature and the landscape in the heart of the city and are also used to connect north and south. It's a completely different park than the park areas they already have. It's much more natural, less programmed also, open, wide, and it also has the water dynamics, of course. This is the map we made for this plan, the design and the map. The map has different layers. A layer of what we planned to build, so the construction drawings, but also a Photoshop that showed how we think the landscape could develop, because the floodplain has many soft banks, and the shapes of the banks can also change by the stream, the currents. The western part of the area is very open. It's an event area also. Here's the new bridge of the city ring. And there's also a new path structure with a bridge that connects the existing dike to this peninsula. This is the central part with a hard K on the north side that could be part of the urban development. It's still being planned, but it will be constructed in the end. And the urban development can also take place on this raised island in the middle of the floodplains. And these are houses that were already there. And these are new houses that are built back, because also some houses needed to be moved over here. And you can also see the inlet. And this is the natural area at the inlet site. Like I said, a park area with different kinds of possibility for use, but not really programmed. There are almost no buildings in the area itself. And the people started to discover it and also started are using it very well at the moment. Like you can see here, this is during quite calm situations, but even if it's high water and there are big currents, then this is an event to take your canoe and to start to float in the streams here. It's a special thing. Many bridges are constructed, designed by different architects. And this one is a very special one. It's a bridge that can flood. And that's also a special event. It's the bridge to the event area. In normal circumstances, you follow this path. And if the water is raising, there's a moment that you can only reach the peninsula by making use of those stepping stones. And it's really an event that people are queuing for it to experience this. Some construction images from the air, this one. And this as an end result. And also in case of quite high water levels, you can see that the inlet is almost covered by water over here. And the area is seen from the south, the side of the old city, and you can also start see that the expansion of the new residential areas is going quite hard at the moment. And here from the west, overlooking the whole area, the both sides of the city. Isle Delta, but quicker, this one. This is the city of Kampen, in a real delta area with different river branches originally. They are all closed, except from the main river course. This is the former Zuiderzee, in which big polar areas are constructed. And the city of Kampen. Let's see. Oh, I need to skip this one. Ah, here it is. Yeah. And as part of the Roeve River plans, a completely new river bypass river course is constructed over here at the south of the city. Here you can see the concept again, an inlet over here, which actually nothing more than a little dike that can flood. New dikes that are constructed, almost 15 kilometers of new dikes, a new division of the lakes that were already here, the opening of this sluice that was already there is going to be removed, and the water can not only pass like this, but also like this at the moment, so that there's much more space for the river and high water levels over here in the city of Kampen, but also much further upstream are prevented. Well, Kampen is a medieval city also. You can see here the urban bottleneck that's there at the place where the river connects to the former sea. The south from the city was a very open agricultural land, but with a lot of remains of old dike breaches. Yeah? The interaction between the sea and the river was here a very big thing always. Here you can see an old picture from the 18th century with the different river branches. Most of them are closed. And there's the picture of the plan where a new river branch is constructed again. Some pictures of how the area grew through the ages. So it is an interaction of the river, the delta deposits, and the different polders that were made there, like this. And here on the south side of the existing city, there were still some remains of the old interaction. There were little lakes, yeah, as a result of an old dike breach. The old dike ring from the south was going like this. The old dike from the north was going like this. And we positioned the new bypass just in between those two old dike rings. The idea was also to design it as a real river branch with a sluice that also connects the IJssel water to the bypass river branch. So it's also interesting for recreation shipping and whole new quiet routes exist. And it's also a natural area in which the water can flow, and it can also move, caused by the winds that are mainly from the west blowing up here. And suddenly the water can raise and can lower. And that's interesting for the nature development over here. The map again, you can see here that this part is a bit drier because the fluvial ridge, and it becomes really wet, also former peatland, and the existing breaches and lakes that were integrated, and the river, the branch we designed, widens and flows like a wide river into the existing water of this this lake. So pictures from here. This is the old dike that's still there. It still needs to be removed. The inlet construction, the sluice, the new dike on the north side, and the new dike on the south side. The sluice again, also designed with a minimum of fences and everything, yeah? like really like a thing architecture and landscape. The central part that's really wet, the highway that's led over this area. The same happened with the railway. And here, look from the east to the west, where the river bench becomes wider and wider and ends up in a big marshland with a lot of reed. Some of the bridges, the main road, a local road with very thin pillars standing in the water, one big line of 400 meters. And the area is really, really wet. And depending of the wind, it's almost completely wet from between the dikes, or you see a little bit of land. And here is the city at the background. The city is also making plans to expand, and the new dikes will become a natural border in the end. The dike design, the dike has cycle paths almost along its whole length. On the northern side, they're positioned high so that you can overlook the area. And the southern side is more quiet, with a path as a track, much lower, so that you feel part of the nature. A view from the dike, top of the dike, over this track, through the inlet construction. And here you see the sluice I already showed. Okay, I have one more project that's maybe a quick look, not completely. It's also about working together with engineers, of course. There are a lot of standards for constructing dikes. For dikes, a special clay is needed. And this clay is then transported from somewhere in the country to a project. That's not very sustainable because of transport, of course. And it also lets always to the same types of dikes. This is a special area. It's along the Moose River. Where dikes needed to be constructed, but it was originally a valley shape with terraces, so an area without dikes. I'm going to skip this a bit, but this is maybe the most interesting. We developed some new types of dikes together with the engineers that were completely different than the standard dike building in the Netherlands. In orange, you see dikes with constructed with a steep edge. The dotted lines are dikes that are completely covered in higher ground, so extra ground is used here. In red, a hard case, and in some parts it was needed to construct a classical dike, that are the green lines. And here you can see what happened. This was the idea before we were involved in the plan: construct standard dikes with slopes, a top and slope again on this side. And our proposal was to cover up the whole area between a natural terrace edge and a new dike, and extend it a bit and design it as steep as possible. Another proposal was to build a high ground dike, so with very gentle slopes, also higher than possible, with a land use that rolls over it without any barrier in between. This idea was very beneficial for the whole ground and soil balance in this project. But first, it was not allowed, but because it didn't meet the standards of the commissioner and the water board. So our team needed to prove that those dikes were strong enough, if we could make them, build them up in this section, and also make use of ground, of soil, that was found locally, because it was different than the standard. So it was really tested in a gulf a gutter, where a little bit of dike was built up, and it got hit during a certain period of time by water to see if there was no damage going on. Now, in the end, this appeared to be a successful concept, and this is the way it's being built. For the water board, it was a strange thing a bit, and they need to get used to it, because those dikes can also erode a bit. And this area is filled up. It almost doesn't look like a dike. This is the floodplain, and this dike can erode. And of course, the erosion and the steep edges are very beneficial for all kinds of ecology. And here you see it from the top again, and we also redesigned the ecological structures, the streams that connect to the Moose River, an image from the field. The whole movement of the water fluctuation in time is part of the experience, of course, in the area, as part of the design. So parts of the areas are not accessible during high waters. So so far this overview of three projects, Room for River, and also some things about dike reinforcement, the other approach. I promised with Dirk that he would switch back again. Somehow I must stop my screen.
Yeah, but and then, David and Kate, maybe we could switch to the Q&A directly, because otherwise I would sort of use up all the time to 7:30 for us and 1:30 for you. So maybe we change to the Q&A.
I think that's a great idea. And well, if everyone could go on their Zoom squares, and David will help moderate a few questions. It's just stunning, stunning work. Like even this last image that you closed on very quickly was quite beautiful, and the time lapse of change within this landscape. So let's have some questions. David, I'll turn it to you.
Okay, thank you, Kate. Thanks, Dirk and Peter, for a double header, if you will. Theory and practice, which is gives us all, you know, something to think about, depending on our tendencies of thinking and doing. I'm just going to start in with some questions that some students have posed. I hope that the students at some point, perhaps during their discussions today, could look at the quadrant model, which I think is absolutely worth its own incredible set of questions. And maybe there's some kind of quadrant overlay we could create to destabilize the destabilization. But anyway, one question has to do with the relationship between dike building and revising the concept of dikes to essentially broaden the scope of a mediated landscape. And what is the relation of that to architecture? Some students are wondering, if landscape will meet architecture in some other way, and if that's been part of your study, or perhaps some of your consultants or partners have also added to what I'm calling this kind of extension or mediation of landscape. So it's essentially the architects of the MSAUD are wondering what else. How can we extend your thoughts about this new form of landscape into some kind of architectural practice?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What can I say about that? In fact, what we are doing is also a kind of architecture, of course, eh? But it's like the Wolf River project is more a framework design almost. Eh? It's designing the framework in which the development of the area can take place. So we are also not designing an end result somehow, eh? But we're designing the conditions for the future development, and I think also for the future architecture. Of course, if we take Rover River as an example, I think this works out quite well. For example, in Nijmegen, you can divide the whole layout of the plan in different areas with different types of different qualities. The urban expansion can react on that. If you build on the one place, it's going to look completely different than in another place, I think. But what you could do as an architect I think always zoom out to the bigger scale. That's one thing, of course. Eh? Try to discover the system that you have impact on. Eh? That's something. In the Netherlands, it's on the level of the building. It's quite clear. Eh? It's a building in the floodplains, for example, is simply not allowed. Usually, So very innovative solutions, like I have seen in New Orleans, building on stilts or whatever, interesting, but we don't do it very often. We build behind the dikes and we make those dikes as strong as possible. Is that a bit of...
A related question is, what is the relationship between government-owned land and private-owned land or cooperatives or whatever?
It depends a bit on where you are. Some of the land that was included in Ruth River, existing floodplains, some of it was already owned by nature organizations. But most of the land that's added to the river, river expansion, was privately owned. So it took many years actually to get all those people involved and also ask those people to sell their land. And in the end, it's possible because it's for public need to force someone to sell the land for a project like this. But the projects I'm involved in, it's in the end, it was not necessary. Some farmers, they were helped to start over again in a different place. For example, that happened in the Kampen area.
If I may add something, David, I've been involved in the first phase of Room for the River as a state advisor on landscape and chair of the quality team. And what we saw was that the basic, paradigm shift of not automatically raising the dikes, but give more room to the river, which to my mind is a very wise choice because, this climate change is not ending at 2050. It's also not ending in the year 2100. It's not going to end in the year 2200. So it's not going to be that in 100 years there will be loudspeakers shouting to all the Dutch people, okay, Dutchies, this was a drill, well done, I lower the temperature again, that will not happen. But giving more room to the river was also shifting from, the easy solution that on the land of the water board, you are strengthening the dike, but all the solutions that Peter showed makes it evident that you have to deal with other forms of land use. And that was the main driver to make it into an integral approach and not only a water safety approach, because we were forced to deal with farmers, with municipalities, with leisure projects, et cetera, et cetera. So, in a way, the dividing line between what was privately owned and what was publicly owned was made, it was less clear than in the traditional way of planning our water safety projects.
I think that another question that several students are hinting at is that, if I can put it in slightly different terms, is that when some of these places are densified or urbanized, what is the next phase? So in Room for the River, there seems to have been a prediction of certain densification and growth. And so is there one, a time frame? You're hinting there kind of isn't one, but the second is also, what is the effect downriver or upriver or whatever the right term might be, further out in the boulder or something like that? I mean, how does this, even though you're already dealing with the large scale, how do you deal with the even larger scales? In many ways, you're begging that question.
Yeah. Well, it's all let's say, cut up in project areas, and each project area got its own target in lowering the mean high water level. And that's all calculated for the whole Dutch river area. But there are also, of course, upstreams effects in the German and even the Swiss part. So all these countries work together. But in a way, looking at the topographic map of the Netherlands, the people from Rijkswaterstaat and the ministry concluded that we still are in the situation where we can give more room to the river, because the river runs through agricultural lands. And in a way, you don't know what, let's say, the situation in 100 years or 150 years from now is. All the fertile deltas in the world might be the last safe haven for millions of climate migrants, for instance. So it is not impossible that our whole delta will be urbanized 150 years from now. And now we are in, still have the opportunity to give it more room. Well, if we wait for a scenario like that to emerge, we won't have the possibility anymore to give more room to the river.
No, I agree. And in addition to that also, that well, there are still a lot of measures on the shelf somewhere, because only a part of the possibilities was selected. But I think that every next measure is more difficult than the one before, because I think, that's because of the densification, of course. But there's also some other things going on, because Room for River was an answer to dike raising, so hardening the dike. But it's not a river for the dikes being weak. The dikes need to be stronger. And because of new calculations, engineers know a lot more about how strong a dike is. And there still are, again, a big dike reinforcement program going on, mainly responding to that mechanism. Dikes need to be stronger also. So, the main direction of thinking is now focused on the dikes instead of making more space. Again, it was a pretty short time frame we were working on.
I think one, Dirk, you mentioned climate migrants, and to me that brings up a kind of global issue, which is that in places like you've already learned in New York City, where communities in place are not going to take some of the required changes, so-called required changes, without drastic change. And so the big U is undergoing considerable tension over the recent plan to like just destroy a park and put another one on top of it. But more broadly, and we hope to have you back to look at the Mississippi work that studio is doing, because there's incredible already kind of difficult situations for many populations, for many groups along the river. And so I would say you've developed a certain set of schemes and certain working methods, but in some ways we're dealing with very built up, very very underserved areas, and a system that is like two generations more unsophisticated than the ones you've been developing. So in some ways, the social problem, the political problem, kind of becomes more difficult. And so I'm not sure if this is a question so much as an invitation that we need you to weigh in on kind of the various community solutions that might emerge from the work the students are currently doing.
Yeah. And Peter, what is your experience with the community approach of rebuild by design? Because we were also involved there. like Kate knows.
Yeah, actually two different thoughts. I think the community and involvement of the community is much stronger, I think, than in the Netherlands than we used to have. Maybe it's improving a bit now. I can remember one exhibition we made for when the first plans for the river bypass in Kampen were becoming clear. And we needed to be there, asking the commissioner, with I think 15 consultants to meet all those people who wanted to talk about it. The whole evening, three people, no one. So no one was interested in that time. And of course, it improved when the plans became clearer and construction started. But and that's already, I think, very very strong in my experience in the US. But my personal experience, and I can, when we started at the Rebuild by Design competition, for example, then we came up with a plan. To redirect sediments in the whole marshlands, cut off a sand that was closed, and built large dams that could block the waves and ridges and everything. Very very big. Huh? So it was a system approach, and I think it ended up with a concrete project. Huh? We were asked to work out. And it ended up with some little weirs somewhere in a pond and some ditches around some houses. So from very big, it got very small, and it happened in a few months. Mm-hmm. So, and that's because there's no commissioner to make those plans, and there's also no commissioner to build, and no commissioner to maintain. And that's completely different, of course. Yeah. So,
And what we noticed, we sort of, have the illusion that the United States of America is almost the same as Europe. And in working in Rebuild by Design, we discovered that there are complete, but really complete differences, that when we were proposing things like dikes, there would be people in the community standing up and shouting, but that's communism. So there is a completely different, let's say, way of looking at planning and doing something collectively, etc. That is really a remarkable difference between the two countries.
On that note, as Zizek said, we can't imagine the end of capitalism. I'll have to say thank you and thank the students for submitting some questions, and it was really enjoyable to see your work and to hear your theorization of the work, which I'm a big fan that we need to really have that kind of dual approach to these questions. You make a great team, so we thank you so much. I hope the students, as you shift over to your discussion sections, can you know, have a good time. There's lots of details to talk about, as well as positions and political aspects. So, Kate, unless you want to say anything, then let's just say goodbye.
Just thank you again. Stunning, and so glad to have you as part of this learning experience. And hopefully, all the students wherever they are in the world will have a chance to meet and discuss the work that you've shown today. So, thanks again, and we'll be in touch about participating on a review very soon. Thank you. Okay, goodbye, everybody.
Thank you.
Have a great day.
Goodbye, okay. David. Thank you, Kate.